Professor Mario Baroni. He's a former director in the Department of the Music University of Bologna. And he'll be talking to us about the indisciplinarity in the study of music. So welcome, Professor Baroni.
Thank you very much for your presentation. The conference invites us to highlight the relation between today's scientific knowledge and the music theories that could derive from it. I would first like to point out that a large part of those invited to the conference are scientists working in different fields, scientists who are interested in music, while I am a musicologist who is interested in scientific research. So our points of view are differently oriented, but this could also be a positive aspect. My conversation will be dedicated to music theory. Truly a strange concept, characterized by a secular or even millenary continuity, but also by a singular instability and continuous uncertainties and transformation. This is music theory. I will begin from the example of Severinus Boetius. His aim was to explain the music of his time. And in order to expound his theory, he turned to the philosophical, mathematical, and astronomical research of his era, which had roots in Greek philosophy. Boethius believed that the relations between the notes, that is their tonal properties, those that he considered perceptible through our sense of hearing, and that he called musica humana, were linked to the mathematical ratios, the harmonies, as he named them, that governed the relations between the stars in the sky, musica mundana. The theories of Boethius are important because they remained alive throughout the Middle Ages, the Renaissance, but when the relations between men and between the social classes began to substantially change, a change also necessarily came about the philosophical principles, including music theory. And so after many centuries, the so-called Baroque epoch saw the emergence of new modes of reflection on music, associated with a growing freedom of thought and of action in the fields of religion, the study of nature, business, economy, and obviously also the arts. All the arts began to leave the boundaries of a world in which thought was collectively shared and to turn to the individual display of affect. Music did so, for example, with the madrigal and then with monody and opera. Descartes' treatise on the Passions of the Soul, 1649, is the philosophical equivalent of these tendencies. The substratum of mathematical knowledge as seen by Boethius certainly did not disappear from music theory, but a reflection on the theory of the affects, which the German scholars called Affektenlehre, began to emerge as a new and more up-to-date approach. This obviously occurred because the trends of musical style were now changing, and new theories were necessary to explain these new tendencies. But such theories did not depend solely on the observation of music. They were also based on what the new scientific knowledge and new philosophical thought of the time could offer. A freer, more secular, and less dogmatic discipline, a new way of observing and studying the things of the world and of the music. Obviously, I cannot set down now the whole story of the theories. From this moment, I shall limit myself to aspects of modern thinking, and particularly to the second half of the 19th century, when some new ideas radically transformed the ancient music theory. The starting point of such transformation coincides with the birth of the so-called German Musikwissenschaft, when the traditional theory changed its name in that of a science of music, Musikwissenschaft, musicology in English. In the preceding centuries, music theory, in spite of its efforts of explaining the nature of the music of its time, fundamentally had remained a discipline for composers. Its aim was to teach composition. With Musikwissenschaft, music gradually became a historical object to be studied in connection with other artistic activities on the basis of two recently born disciplines, aesthetic philosophy and the philosophy of history. The most interesting European results in the 19th century were mainly relative to the history of music. Particularly, German musicologists worked in the publication of ancient sources, the masterpieces of ancient music, and of great biographies, for example, of Handel and Bach. But Guido Adler, in 1885, proposed a distinction between historical and systematical musicology. In the following years, the study of non-European music, then named comparative musicology, became a new particular branch of musicology. And another branch, applied musicology, included a number of new sub-disciplines, as in music therapy, music education, musical criticism, and so on. As a result of these processes, today's musicology cannot be more conceived as a single entity. It has become a disciplinary area where many possible disciplines can be present. In 2004, Richard Pankhurst published a short history of multi and interdisciplinary musicology. In his little book, he listed a number of disciplines pertaining to the systematic musicology. By systematic musicology, he says, we mean theory, analysis, psychology, acoustics, psychoacoustics, sociology, aesthetics, philosophy, physiology, informatic sciences, mathematics, popular music, jazz, technological media. Just in those years, started a cycle of conferences on interdisciplinary musicology and a society for interdisciplinary musicology was born in 2012, encouraging people from distant disciplines to work together. According to Richard Pankhurst, a common reaction of many researchers to this multiplicity of disciplines was to aim at the safety of one's own subdiscipline and to ignore the possible contribution of other subdisciplines. And conventional hierarchical university structures tended to encourage this kind of response. In his short history, Pankhurst wrote also, scientists often have serious difficulties understanding the concerns and arguments of humanities scholars, and vice versa. And I think that on this point, he mentioned the presence of a real principal problem. In fact, in the years that followed, the conflict between a monocentric theoretical conception and an interdisciplinary approach has not been fully resolved. And I don't think that musicological institutions have reached till now globally accepted and common solutions. I believe that besides the contrasting approaches to the organization of research, it is now much more important to stress the growing number of studies which has been published in recent years and are going to be published in future. And to this argument, I will devote the following last part of my speech. Unfortunately, the amount of subjects is really huge. I will have only the time to simply name, without closer examinations, some leading musically significant scientific activities. I can do so, however, because in-depth analysis will follow in the next communications of my colleagues in the present conference. In this last section, I will mention examples initially coming from natural sciences and afterwards from human sciences. My first mention will be for acoustic physics. Today's knowledge in acoustic physics is quite complex, not only due to the scientific developments in this sector, but also because new issues have arisen in the language of music itself. Such issues regarded above all the wide use of orchestral timbres and the increasingly more widespread use of dissonances and noise, not to mention the electronic means of producing sounds that have supplemented the natural emissions of voices and instruments. Acoustic physics is the main scientific discipline able to give substantial inputs to a new music theory, which is open to the innovation of the new music and no more exclusively linked to tonal traditions. But the study of the relations between such a varied and diverse assortment of physical phenomena has turned given rise to research on other subjects, for example, on the physical structures of the human ear. The description of hearing processes implies a number of phases, the passage between the pressures of the air and the marvelous machines of the inner ear, the functions of the acoustic nerve, and the final synthesis of the brain, what we call the perception of sound. Obviously, mathematics have had a primary function in all the just mentioned studies. And we know that its function was always emphasized since ancient epochs. But we know also that today's mathematics has reached new levels of depth and complexity. So it's worth quoting the activities of the Society for Mathematics and Computation in Music, and especially of its journal. Furthermore, the analysis of sounds has been extended to much more broadly biological events, for example, to the acoustic perception of animals. In this case, the idea of music became quite removed from what it had always traditionally been in the minds of Western men and women. And probably also for such reasons, it is rather difficult to be appropriately and clearly now described. Inevitably, the studies of a phylogenetic nature found a parallel in aspects of ontogenesis. So in the 9th International Conference of Music Perception and Cognition held in Bologna in 2006, Ian Cross spoke on musical phylogenesis and Michel Amberti on musical ontogenesis. Unfortunately, however, we have no time to discuss here their interesting presentations. To pass down to the field of human sciences, I will mention three sectors: the sciences of the mind, the sciences of society, and the sciences of language. In the sciences of the mind, an enormous bibliography has in fact generated as a true sub-discipline, the psychology of music. This discipline has countless branches, such as the study of perception, that of the cognitive activities, that of the emotions in music, without forgetting the widely discussed contributions of psychoanalysis. Sociology, in its turn, has provided essential tools for understanding the huge changes that characterized the political and cultural history of Europe since the Middle Ages. Sociology. The political changes obviously influenced culture and music. The dominant classes, the social categories which in different epochs had the power to impose cultural rules to the members of its society, promoted the affirmation of particular functions of music, and of course, of particular styles of music, with major consequences on the identity of professional musicians and on those who listen to music. The study of non-European cultures has similarly been an essential point of reference to relativize, this time in space, not only in time, the nature of music, as not to confuse the phenomenon of music with Euro-American music. For example, the great musical traditions of China, India, Japan, and Indonesia gave us new sources of knowledge, which helped us to think a better and wider definition of music. Finally, the sciences of language have introduced subdisciplines like the semiotics of music. So musicologists were encouraged to observe that in music, as in languages, are not only present phonetic and syntactic rules able to create musical grammars, but there are also aspects of communication. In the field of communication, the most evident difficulty lies in the fact that musical contents, which do not use words and have no lexicon, are of a totally different nature to compared to those of languages, and for these reasons are much more difficult to investigate. A lot of research has been devoted to musical meaning, that is, the ways by which music can allude to external events, and to musical topics, that is, lists of events of the world traditionally linked to aspects of sound structures. And this opened new paths for a better grasp of the problem of what we are used to call musical signification. As for music analysis, I would like to point out that the best known analytical techniques, for example, Schenkerian, Neo-Riemannian, and set analysis, were born to obtain in an in-depth description of the tonal, late tonal, or post-tonal features, which are exclusively typical of syntactic aspects and of aspects of European music. The just quoted analysis do not cover all the analytical and the theoretical questions that music theory is expected to resolve. Firstly, they have been applied to a reduced percentage of the musical creations existing and analyzable today. Secondly, they focused their attention on the aspects of musical syntax that, although important, do not exhaust the overall system of the structural parameters that characterize music as a means of communication. The problem with the past slide. The first slide was had the title of a final remark. Finally, I would like to add note a last remark. I wish to conclude by stressing that the theory of music has doubtlessly become extremely complex and perhaps under particular aspect almost inseparable for a part of interested but not specialized subjects. And now we arrived to the present slide, the modified musicological language. I believe that the specialists in a non-musical scientific field have now a new important task. Their contribution must be disseminated, but must be understandable to those not belonging to their specific field. So scientific divulgation has a major job, that of gradually modifying the current musicological language. Disciplines with their own closed terminology are of no use to musicology. Musicians and musicologists can only benefit from those disciplines that are able, with suitable terminologies, to make their contents fully accessible to the musicological world. Obviously, those attending this conference, precisely on account of the fact that they are here, have no need to be reminded of this point. But I have sometimes come up against serious difficulties in fully understanding articles coming from disciplines I am not familiar with. So to conclude, I believe that disciplinarity also incorporates the meaning of a real and concrete interaction, and not just a simple commonality of purposes, between musicology and the disciplines that are external to it. Thank you very much for your attention.